Hello, my name is Will van der Aalst. I'm from RWTH Aachen University, and it is a great pleasure to present this paper, which has the title Reduction Using Induced Subnets to Systematically Prove Properties for Free Choice Nets. So it's a great pity that we cannot join all together the conference in Paris. There is already a preprint available of the paper that is also in the proceedings. I would also like to point out work that uses a completely different approach and considers a different class of models, but which has quite some similarities in terms of the goals that it tries to achieve. That paper was just accepted for Fundamental Informatica, and there is a preprint reference here, and I will come back to that paper towards the end because I think it's very interesting if you are interested in the topic of the paper that I'm presenting now. So we all know the possibility to reduce a larger Petri net into a smaller Petri net in such a way that certain properties are being preserved. So here you see a model that was discovered using process mining, using the inductive miner based on SAP data. And in process mining terms, this is a super small model. It's easy to generate process models that have hundreds or thousands of different transitions and places to describe the behavior that was seen in the data. But that's not the topic of the talk. I just illustrate this. We have possibly larger models, and through reductions or reduction rules, we can make them smaller. And here I show a reduction where we end up with a process model with four transitions at the end. So often we apply reductions in such a way that we would like to reason about these models, or we would like to prove that the larger model has certain properties, and that implies that the smaller model has these properties, or the other way around. To be more precise, let's talk about the original model and the reduced model. A property X is preserved downstream if the original model satisfies property X, then it is guaranteed that the reduced model also satisfies property X. Property X is preserved upstream. If the reduced model satisfies the property, then this implies that also the original model, so the larger model, satisfies this property X. So what are typical candidates for property X? This could be well-known properties like liveness, boundedness, well-formed is the free choice property, but it could also include newer topics like, for example, lucency, which I will explain in the second part of my talk. Note that in this paper, the focus is on well-formed nets. So if we have workflow nets as we see them here, we always short-circuit them. So the final place is again connected through the source place through an additional transition. So this is a standard construct. So reduction rules are of course not very new. The first reduction rules were already presented in the 70s. In the 80s, these reduction rules were also developed specifically for free choice nets. If you look at the standard, let's say, book on free choice net theory, that you can see here, written by Jorg Dijssel and Javier Esparza. In this book, there are three rules which are presented, which have the following property: that if we apply these rules, then if the original net is well formed, then the reduced net is also well formed. And this holds also in the other direction. So if the reduced net is well formed, also the original net is well formed. Moreover, these rules are complete. And completeness means that if the original model is well formed, then it's possible to reduce that original model to a model that consists of just a place and a transition, as you can see here. In the completeness proof, the so-called CP nets are being used. And that is related to the T reductions that I will talk about later. This work is highly related to what I will be talking about. So in this paper, I will introduce T-induced T-nets. As mentioned, this is related to CP nets. I will introduce the new concept of a P-induced P-net, which is the kind of the dual notion of a T-induced T-net, as we will see in a minute. I will show that it's always possible to reduce a model, and in every reduction step, it is possible to choose from two alternatives. What I mean exactly by that will become clear later. I will show that using such reductions, well-formedness, liveness, boundedness, PC, safeness, and perpetuality are preserved downstream, so going from the larger to the smaller model, and assuming certain side conditions, lucency, which is a very important property, is preserved upstream. And this is used as an example to show and to explain that this is a generic framework to reason about, let's say, nets using these T and P reductions. So let's start by the defining precisely what I mean by a T-induced T-net. So here is the definition that you can also find in the paper. And the basic idea is that from a chosen transition, we grow a subnet. So what we see is that if the transition, if we pick a transition, we for every transition that is already in there, we try to expand it. And we are interested in looking at output places of a transition that is already in our subset that have exactly one input and exactly one output. If a transition is in the set and it is connected to a place that has precisely one input arc and one output arc, it is expanded in that way. If a place is in there, then automatically also all the output transitions are included. And so this way we look at the smaller set that satisfy these properties. I will explain this in a moment a bit more visual. So then we have a subnet, and that is called the T-induced T-net. And such a T-induced T-net is called proper if the complement is strongly connected. And the complement is simply the original net minus the T-induced T-net. This is all very difficult to understand without an example, so I just show an example, but I just won't like to be very precise. So we create a T-induced T-net by picking an arbitrary transition. And of course, that transition is in the T-induced T-net. So we start here, and then we try to grow the set of nodes that we have selected, indicated here in red. And there are two rules that we apply. So if a transition is already in the set, then all the output places that have exactly one incoming arc and one outgoing arc are added. So in this example, T1 has two output places, and these output places have one input and one output, so they are added. In the next step, I try to apply another rule, and that rule basically says that if a place is in the set, then we add all output transitions. So that means in this example, we add T3 and T4. And the two rules that I just explained, we apply them iteratively as long as we can, right? And at some point in time, we can no further expand the network, and then it stops. So this is the idea of a T-induced T-net. Here I show another example. If we would start with T3, so T3 is in the set, and then we try to expand it. But if we look at the output places of T3, that is place P7, but P7 does not satisfy this property that it has one input and one output. So it immediately stops here. So T3 in isolation is a T-induced T-net. Now we can look at T7, and the same reasoning applies. So we try to expand T7, but it immediately stops because the output places of T7, both of them, have multiple output arcs. So we cannot expand it further. So T7 in isolation is also a T-induced T-net. So now we know what the T-induced T-net is, and we say that such a T-induced T-net is proper if the complement is strongly connected. And so in this example, we look at the T1-induced T-net, which is highlighted in red. And if we remove that part, we get another Petri net, which we call the complement, and that complement is strongly connected. And because this complement is strongly connected, we say that the T1-induced T-net is proper. If we try to do that, so we have identified that just T3 in isolation is also a T-induced T-net. But if we remove T3, and I'm showing that here on the right, then we see that it is no longer strongly connected. So T3 has no outgoing arcs, so it cannot be strongly connected. So this is not proper. So the T3 induced T-net is not proper. The same holds for the T7 induced T-net. That is also not proper, because if we remove T7, then what we see is that it is no longer strongly connected. So for example, P1 and P2 have no longer input arcs. P7 and P8 no longer have output arcs. So these are not proper. And we are now interested in proper T-induced T-nets. We remove them and we look at the complement, and that complement is still strongly connected. So here you see, as I focused before on the T1-induced T-net, here you see in blue the T2-induced T-net. And if we remove that, we get a net that is still strongly connected. So that was the T-induced T-net. Now we look at the P-induced P-net. And now we basically start from a place and go in the other direction. So you could think of this as the jewel of what I explained before. Here you see the formal definition, and again we define a P-induced P-net. We define when it is proper, and we define the notion of a complement. So again, I will try to show this graphically. So in the P-induced P-net, we start by picking a place. So here I start by picking P7. And now we work in the other direction. Again, we have two rules to expand this. So the two rules that we have, the first rule is that if we have a place and that place has input transitions, and these input transitions have precisely one input and one output, we add them to the set. That's the rule that you see here. So P7 has two input transitions that both have one input arc and one output arc, and that's why we add both of them. And so T3 and T5 are added to the set. Then we have another rule, just like with the T-induced T-nets. So if we have a transition that is included, then automatically all of the input places, no matter what their connections are being added, and this is what this rule says. And we try to iteratively apply these rules until we can no longer expand it, and here in this setting it stops, because for example, if we look at P3, P3 has T1 as an input transition, but T1 has multiple inputs and multiple output arcs. The same for if you look at P5, P5 has two T2 as input transition, but also there it stops because T2 has multiple input and output arcs. And we only expand if the transition would have precisely one input and one output. So in this example, we find that there are two proper P-induced P-nets, where proper refers again to the fact that if we remove it, that it is strongly connected. And they are highlighted here. And again, we are interested in the complement. If it's proper, the complement remains strongly connected. So here, if we remove the P7-induced PNET, then we end up with the model that you can see on the right-hand side. If we start from P8, we look at the P8-induced PNET here in blue. If we remove it, we end up with a net that is still strongly connected. So that's the basic idea. And so we have a mechanism given a larger model, how we can make it smaller, starting from a place or starting from a transition. So why is this interesting and why is this relevant? Well, first of all, we can prove that if we start with the well-formed free choice nets, that is a free choice net that is not yet a T-net, we can always apply a reduction. And so we can always apply a T reduction if the net is not yet a T-net. The same for let's say P-nets. So if we have a well-formed free choice net and that net is not yet a P-net, we can apply a reduction. And what is very important for the proofs that I used in the paper is that if we can reduce it, we always can choose from two transitions. And so there are two different transitions, T1 and T2, such that the T1 induced T-net is proper and the T2 induced T-net is proper. So taking the complement can be repeated until we end up with a T-net or a P-net, and in every step we can choose from two different reduction actions. So what I just said was preparing for, let's say, more larger and more involved proofs. So one of the things that we can prove is that through such reductions, liveness, boundedness, well-formedness, and the free choice property are preserved. So if we apply such a reduction, in other words, we cut away, for example, in the example at the bottom, a T1-induced T-net, if we cut that away and it was proper, then we know that the resulting net, if the original net was live, the resulting net is live, bounded, well-formed, and free choice. This also applies to let's say, reductions involving starting from a place. And so if we have a proper P-induced P-net, then after removing it, if the original net was well-formed and free choice, the result is also well-formed and free choice. If the original net was live and bounded, then the reduced net is live and bounded. And of course, this can be applied in a sequence. As I just explained one step, and we can apply this in a sequence, and we can repeat this until we end up with a T-net and or a P-net. And so as long as we do not, if we look at the free choice net and the free choice net is not yet a T-net, we can apply another T reduction. If it's not yet a P-net, we can apply another P reduction. And we can repeat this until we get a T-net or a P-net. And if we apply both, we end up with a net that is both a P-net and a T-net. So just to sketch it a bit, I make it a bit graphical. So here I pick an arbitrary proper induced subnet, here the one defined by P7. I basically take the complement. So if the original one was, for example, well-formed, I know that the resulting one will also be well-formed. And I can apply it iteratively. So here I pick P1, and I try to expand it, and it doesn't go any further. So, but if I remove it, it's still strongly connected. So it's proper. And in different steps, I end up with a model, as you can see here. Here I'm doing, a T1-induced T-net that I cut away. And here, by applying all of these rules, I end up with a net that is both a P net and a T net. So that's the basic idea. So what we have seen, any well-formed free choice net can be turned into a well-formed T net by applying a complete T reduction. Yeah, so that we reduce as long as we can do it. What order, what choices we make is irrelevant. We always end up with the T net. We can also apply a sequence of, let's say, these P reductions, and what we end up is a P net. And if the original net was well formed, the reduced net is also well formed. And we can mix these P and T based reductions in any way we want. There are subtle details which are very important in the proofs, is that in every reduction step, we always have a choice. So if there is a T-induced T-net, there are always two. If there is a P-induced P-net, there are always two. And so we can always choose. Something that I did not detail, but which is in the paper detailed a lot, of course, if we are cutting away parts where there are tokens in, we need to handle that situation in a particular way. I will not dwell on that, but in the paper this is described very, very, very precisely. So this is the framework, and this is basically the idea that we would like to apply. Let's now apply this type of reasoning to nets that are perpetual and nets that are loosened. And what I mean by these concepts, you will find out in a minute. So far I've been talking about liveness, boundedness, well-formedness, things that are very well studied in the PetriNet setting. Notions like lucency are, for example, much less investigated, although I think that they deserve much more attention than they are getting so far. So let's first try to define what a perpetual PetriNet is. And to do that, I need to introduce the notion of a regeneration transition. A regeneration transition is a transition that, if we look at the marking that just marks the input places of that transition, that marking is live and bounded. Yeah, so in other words, we pick a transition, we look at the marking that consists of just putting tokens on the input places of that transition, and that marking should define a live and bounded marked PetriNet. So we have the notion of a regeneration transition, and a PetriNet is perpetual if there is such a transition. What is very elegant, if you look closely, is that this doesn't depend on an initial marking. It is a property that is defined at the level of a net. This leads also to other notions, like, for example, PC safely marked nets. And for that, I'm assuming that you know the notion of P components. And what we know is that every well-formed free choice net is covered by P components. But that is not relevant for this definition. This definition says that we have a PC safe marking if every P component contains precisely one token. And so a PetriNet, if it's covered by P components, then in every P component there should be precisely one token. And of course, different P components that are overlapping could share, let's say, a common token. So that is PC safely marked nets. And now we have an interesting relationship, is that if we look at a perpetual well-formed free choice net, so we have a free choice net that we know has a regeneration transition called TR here, then we know that for any marking M is PC safe if and only if the marking, which consists of just marking the input places of TR, which is of course strongly related to the notion of a regeneration marking, is reachable. So here we are simply relating P safeness to marking the input places of a well-formed free choice net that is perpetual. This is very logical if you think about it, because the number of tokens in a P component by definition cannot change. Yeah, so if you think about that, you will see that this lever can be proven very easily. Now I look at the notion of lucency. And lucency is a desirable property in many applications, because it says that there cannot be two markings that two different markings that enable the same set of transitions. So whenever we are in a marking where, for example, three transitions are enabled, that marking has to be unique. There cannot be two markings that enable exactly the same set of transitions. Of course, not all nets satisfy that. It's very easy to create, for example, non-free choice Petri nets with long-term dependencies, where in the beginning you make a choice and that choice has an effect much later in the process. But in the states in between, you cannot see that there is this choice that has already been resolved, and you can only see that later. And so this is not a common property. At first you may think, okay, this holds for any free choice net, and that is not the case. It doesn't even hold for marked graphs or T-nets, as you see here. So here I'm showing one Petri net that has two markings that are visualized here that enable exactly the same set of transitions. And so in both markings, T1 is enabled and T4 is enabled. T2 and T3 are not enabled. So from the enabling perspective, these two markings are indistinguishable. So please note to relate this to P-safeness, because you can see that lucency is also a property that is defined independent of an initial marking. So it talks about P-safe markings. Note that in the example that I have here, there are three P components. So the P component consisting of just P1 and P2, the P component consisting of P3 and P4, etc., etc. And they all have precisely one token. So here we see an example of a net that is not loosened, because we have two different markings that enable the same set of transitions. But this net is not perpetual, because it does not have such a regeneration transition. A transition that that marks its own input places and all the other ones are empty, and we can revisit that as many times as we want. So let's now reason a bit about these properties. So one of the things that you can show is that if the original net is P-safe and we apply different reduction steps, then at all the intermediate steps and also in the end result, if the initial marking was PC-safe, the end result is also PC-safe. What we can also prove is that if the original net is perpetual, then all the intermediate nets and also the final reduced net, they are all also perpetual. So perpetual is preserved downstream. So here I can illustrate that. Here I'm using the example that I showed before. So we are reducing the net in the top left corner in multiple steps to the net in the bottom right corner. And we know that if the original net was perpetual, the one at the end is also perpetual. And all the other ones on the way are also perpetual. The same is for PC safe. If the original net is PC safe, then all the other nets are also PC safe. Lucency, on the other hand, is preserved upstream, assuming that the original net is perpetual. So this is a property that goes into the other direction. And so if the smaller net is loosened, then also the larger nets are loosened. Of course, this is based on the assumption that the original net that we started with was perpetual. And this implies, by applying this iteratively, this implies that all perpetual well-formed free choice nets are loosened. So let's go back to my original sketch of the framework that we are using, and I just illustrated how it works. And so we are interested in reducing a larger Petri net into a smaller one in such a way that properties are either preserved downstream or are preserved upstream. If we now look at the things that we have shown, is that if we assume that the original net is well-formed and free choice, then we also know that the reduced net will be well-formed and free choice. Moreover, under this assumption, if the original net is PC safe, then the reduced net is PC safe. If the original net is perpetual, then also the reduced net is perpetual, and all the Petri nets on the way satisfy the same property. We also have upstream properties, and so this is under the assumption that the original model is well-formed, free choice, and perpetual. And so if we assume that, then if the reduced net is loosened, then also the original net is loosened. And an interesting insight is because it's trivial to prove for P nets and T nets that perpetuality implies that they are loosened. And so for these base cases, we can easily prove that if the net is perpetual, it is also loosened. Because of this upstream property, we can show that any perpetual well-formed free choice net is loosened. That's a very powerful and interesting result. Note that the point was not to show this thing that I showed at the end, because it was shown before. I just wanted to illustrate how we can apply such a framework. So what are the limitations of this framework? Well, of course, the focus is on well-formed free choice nets. Everything breaks if we do not assume that the original net that we start with is well-formed and free choice. What's also a limitation is that it cannot be applied in the reverse direction. And I'm illustrating that here. So the net, so if we start by looking at the net in the left bottom, then the net without the highlighted transition T is well-formed, strongly connected, etc., etc. And so it has all the desired properties. The net with T, and note that I can do a T-induced T-net, that would just consist of T. It is also proper, because if I remove it, it is still connected. However, if we look at the net with T, it is of course no longer well-formed. Please take a look at that, look at the behavior, and you will see, for example, that if we would fire T2, we would end up, for example, with two tokens in P7, and we would end up in a deadlock. So this model is no longer well-formed at the higher level. I could also use the same example using a place P. So the net without the blue place is well-formed. The net with the blue place is no longer well-formed. And so the complement is well-formed, and the induced subnet is proper, but the original net is not well-formed. So we can only apply this in one direction, and that's of course an important limitation. But we are looking at properties where we go from the larger one to the smaller one. So there's of course a lot of related work that I'm not going to discuss in detail. Here are some pointers sorted in time. So already in the 70s and 80s, people worked on reduction rules. Of course, the foundations of free choice net theory, as we know it today, were laid. More recent are works that focus on perpetual nets and lucency, and also reduction rules for other types of nets. At the end, I would like to also highlight a paper that has recently been accepted, which uses a completely different approach. But if you're interested in the topic of this talk, I'm sure that you will also be interested in this paper. So the title of the paper is Free Choice Nets with Home Clusters Are Loosened. So now you think, okay, that is very much related to what I was talking about at the end of presenting the current PatriNet paper. But there is one important difference. Everything that I talked about before assumed well-formedness. Here I'm dropping well-formedness. I do not require that the net is well-formed. And the results that are achieved in this paper are achieved without using all the standard PatriNet machinery. So here I'm highlighting two main results. So if we start with the marked proper free choice net having a home cluster, then the resulting net is loosened, even if the original one was not well formed. We can also solve the following problem in polynomial time. Given a marked proper free choice net, we can decide whether there's a home cluster or not. So just to make it visual without going into the details. So this is a free choice net. It is proper, and proper is a trivial property. It basically says that we cannot have transitions without input arcs and output arcs. So that's like a more simple syntactical requirement that doesn't play a big role. What plays a bigger role is that there should be a home cluster. So that is related to the notion of the net being perpetual. So here, if we look at T8 and the input places of P8, then if that cluster is marked, and that cluster is reachable, and in that cluster, we will never leave it again. So this is a home cluster. We can always reach again this exact marking P7 and P8. So this is a home cluster. And using the results of this paper, that implies that the whole net is loosened. Please note that the net that you're looking at is not strongly connected. This is not well formed. Here's another example. It's even more trivial. So we know that P4 is a home cluster because we can reach it and we can always reach it again. So this is a home cluster, so that implies that it is loosened. Of course, everything that I talk about now also applies to the result that I was presenting before. So the net does not have to be well formed. But of course, if it's well formed, still all the results hold. So this is an important generalization using a completely different approach. So what is interesting is that the proofs here are using new notions like expediting a transition. There is the notion of routed disentangled paths, which are proven to be safe. There's the notion of conflict pairs. And To prove these properties that I just mentioned, it is important that we do not need to use the standard indirect machinery that you know from standard free choice theory. So let's come to a conclusion. So I've presented in this paper a framework to reduce free choice nets in the end to P-nets or T-nets. And the framework ensures that certain properties are being preserved. Using this framework in the future, it will become very easy to prove properties starting from well-formed free choice nets. And because we can basically apply the reductions, and if we say that the property is preserved using one of the reductions, and in the end it holds for a P or a T net, then we can be sure that it holds for all nets. So properties can be preserved upstream and downstream. And I showed you a combination of that. The example application was, let's say, a compact proof that all perpetual well-formed free choice nets are loosened. This is one application. I can also apply the framework to prove the well-known blocking theorem in a much more direct way by using the machinery provided by the framework that I just presented. I also highlighted a new paper that is looking at properties like lucency in a setting where we do not have well-formed free choice nets, so they don't need to be well-formed. They may have deadlocks and these types of things. So what is interesting there is that new concepts are being used that I think will be very influential in the future. If we look at the motivations for this work, which is very much theoretically focused, the original idea came very much from the field of process mining. So the work on reductions was triggered by interactive and incremental process discovery. So in the past, we built interactive editors where, driven by data, the user is guided to extend the model in a particular way based on the evidence in the event logs. And there we incrementally extend the model, which is the inverse of these reduction rules. So that's an important link. There's also an important link to, like if we look at the class of nets, proper free choice nets having a home cluster. Note that this generalizes the standard cyclical case and the idea of, let's say, sound workflow nets in one concept. So in process discovery, we are often interested in nets that have a clear start and a clear end. And this is exactly the case here, but it also extends to situations where the net never has to end. So this is an interesting representational bias, an interesting class of nets to look at. And then the notion of lucency was directly inspired by process mining. So if we cannot have two markings, if we cannot have two different markings enabling the same set of transitions, then you can imagine it is much easier to discover such models based on event data. So in another paper, we also look at the notion of translucent event logs. They do not just say what has happened, but they are also indicating what could have happened. And then there is a very direct link to lucency. As I mentioned at the end, many of these problems are triggered by research in the field of process mining. Therefore, I end with providing a few pointers to, let's say, PetriNet problems that you can look at in the field of process mining. In my view, this is a super interesting killer application for PetriNet theory. And the problems that I sketched in this talk kind of originate from very practical problems coming from this domain. Thank you very much.